Hello, a very good morning to you. Welcome along to another busy old Ireland day.
Absolutely, it's Thursday the 9th of February and it is great to have you with us.
Sure is. Coming up very shortly, well, here, this is a question we're all wondering. Certainly Alan Hughes is going to be getting animated about this one. Should you change from a tracker mortgage? We're going to have the latest expert advice on navigating the ever-changing financial landscape.
And if you want to throw in a question, you can 0896-111-111. Also later on, we're going to be going live to Turkey to hear from the Irish aid worker helping survivors in the aftermath of the earthquake.
Plus, looking forward to this, rugby legend, Irish rugby legend, Shane Byrne and his mullet are going to be here to talk Six Nations and strutting his stuff and dancing with the stars.
I didn't realise that, like, the IRFU tried to get him to cut it.
But I'd say he's kind of hamming that up a bit. But I don't think you're going to get dropped for not cutting your hair.
Or did he?
We're going to find out.
Yeah, absolutely. Alan, have you ever gotten dropped from here for not having your highlights done?
What highlights?
It's all natural, darling. How very dare you? Well, in case you didn't know it, it's World Pizza Day, and we're getting a lot of masterclass in pizza making by the one and only Alberto Rossi. That's coming up a little later on. Also, Brian Lloyd will be giving his verdict on the latest movie and streaming releases. And in fashion, we've got some looks that are perfect for your date night, maybe for Valentine's. Now, Derek, is he right? You're agreeing with that, Alberto?
Nice, yeah. Alberto.
Big time.
Yeah, big time with Alberto. There we go.
Big time.
Derek, where are you this morning?
Yes, good morning. We're up here in Portmarnock in North County, Dublin this morning. It's a cold, a little bit of a frosty and icy start out there this 9th of the month, guys, but with some lovely sunshine, nice bright spells out there this Thursday. But remember that beautiful sunrise we had. Yes, there's so many photos coming in. We're expecting more of the same. We have that gorgeous morning glow coming up here behind me. A beautiful sunrise in and around 7.56. For check-in at the top of the 8 hour, we're going to have a beautiful, beautiful sunrise behind me. We'll catch you later for that.
Looks stunning, Derek. Absolutely stunning this morning. The UFO flying over
his
head.
That was what it was, wasn't it?
As well. Thank you very much, Derek. Great to have you back. Now it's time to get over to the Virgin Media News Hub. Here's Geraldine Nina.
Thanks, Tommy. Good morning. Taoiseach Leo Varadkar is in Brussels to attend a two-day summit of EU leaders. Among the items on the agenda are Russia's war against Ukraine, the economic situation in the EU and migration. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky will address the summit and is expected to appeal for more weapons and fighter jets to help his war efforts.
A packed agenda awaits EU leaders at this two-day summit in Brussels. They'll discuss the latest developments in the ongoing war against Ukraine and continued support for the country, including a 10th round of sanctions against Russia. The EU has already provided €50 billion in assistance to Ukraine. The knock-on impact of the war will be debated with migration issues on the schedule. Government leaders will assess the refugee inflow from Ukraine and the EU's migration and asylum strategy. The EU economy, its long-term competitiveness and the single market are also on the agenda. To respond to the challenges for EU industries, leaders will look at a set of measures that could help in the short term. Trish Laverty, Virgin Media News.
Turkey's President Erdogan has admitted that mistakes were made in his government's handling of the aftermath of two major earthquakes, which have so far killed at least 16,000 people in Turkey and Syria. His government is facing mounting criticism amid accusations that the emergency services response has been too slow. Last night, President Erdogan accepted there were problems with his government's response, but insisted the situation was now under control. Rescue teams are continuing to dig through the rubble of collapsed buildings in an attempt to find survivors. The magnitude 7.8 quake and its aftershocks left a trail of destruction that stretched hundreds of kilometres across the two countries. Thousands of people have been left homeless and were forced to sleep outside again last night. Over a dozen Irish NGOs are on the ground in Turkey and in Syria helping survivors. Health officials will be questioned today on the cost of the cyber attack on the HSC in May 2021. The Public Accounts Committee will hear from Department of Health representatives on the financial impact of the attack, which affected the delivery of healthcare services at the time. Politicians will be examining the measures taken to repair the system and to prevent similar security breaches in the future. The committee will also get an update on the process involved in notifying people whose data was stolen during the attack. Two children are dead after a bus crashed into a daycare centre in Montreal in Canada. Six other children have been taken to hospital. The bus driver has been arrested and charged with homicide and careless driving. Disney is cutting 7,000 jobs, or over 3% of its global workforce. The company's CEO says the move is necessary to address the challenges the company is facing. Other cost-cutting measures have also been announced by Disney, which is aiming to save $5.5 billion across the company. In the US, two men arrested this week in relation to the murder of a teenage girl 47 years ago in Indiana have appeared before a judge. Fred Banty Jr. and John Wayne Lehman, who are both 67, are accused of killing 17-year-old Laurel Jean Mitchell, whose body was found in a stretch of water in August 1975. Her death was initially believed to be a drowning until an autopsy showed that she died violently. Police in Indiana say science helped them make a breakthrough in the cold case. And finally for now, a new species of snake discovered in the jungles of Central and South America has been named after a Hollywood superstar. This red and orange tree snake is one of five newly discovered species and is now known as DiCaprio's tail-eating snake after actor Leonardo DiCaprio, who's a longtime conservationist. The actor is now partnered with a foundation trying to bring awareness to the new species, which is threatened by mining efforts.
For car insurance, van insurance or home insurance, call the Quote Devil. Unless, of course, you've got money to burn.
Thank you, Ger. We're live here in Portmarnock in Dublin this morning. Take a look at that beautiful glow just over my shoulder. We have the most glorious sunrise on the way in and around 7.56. So get the cameras out, get snapping and get your photos into us through our socials right across the morning. Anyway, let's take an opening look at weather together now with Anna Fraser with us on cameras. And it is quite a cold, quite a frosty and a taster of ice out there on the roads this morning. We are seeing showers two parts of eastern Donegal, many there into Ballybofey, through Fermanagh and into Strabane there in County Tyrone. But elsewhere, nice and settled now as we work away over the next couple of hours in those light to moderate south-west to westerly winds. Now, across today, in fact, not a bad one, Joe. We're going to see some nice bright spells on the car, but mainly confined in across eastern and southern parts. Further west and north we go, that's where we're going to see a little bit of cloud rustle up with the odd patchy rain develop towards the back end of the day. Top values of around 8 to 11 degrees. Finally then, tonight, it looks like mainly dry and settled once again. Good clear skies to start. Cloud cover though through parts of the west, bringing with it once again patchy light rain, patchy light drizzle as well. A frost developing underneath clear spells as well. And once again, any damp roads will see ice to take us through tonight into your Friday morning, with valleys on the cold, on the chilly side, back to -1 to +3. Degrees. So that's how we're shaping up here in a cold Portmarnock in North County Dublin. Wrap up if you're out and about, and we'll catch you back live at 7:35.
For first-time drivers, young drivers, returning drivers, if you've had an open claim or have had too many penalty points. The Quote Devil's always got one hell
of a quote. Coming up after the break, Andrea Gilligan will be here to run through the big stories of the day, including Bertie's big bounce back. You don't want to miss it. See you soon.
It's time now to take a look at this morning's papers. We'll start with the Irish Times. Its headline: Erdogan criticised as earthquake death toll climbs above almost 16,000. President Recep Tayyip Erdogan has visited the region of southern Turkey devastated by this week's earthquake, as the death toll is now approaching 16,000, and acknowledged that his government faced problems getting aid to victims.
Electricity firms in hot water over false 100% green claim. That's the front page of the Irish Independent. Electricity companies are misleading hundreds of thousands of customers by claiming to supply 100% renewable power. An advertising watchdog investigation has found.
The Herald goes with, the life was gone out of Cullum's eyes. A Garda has described the moment he rolled over a gunshot victim to discover it was his colleague, Garda Cullum Horkin, telling a jury his eyes were still open, but the life had gone out of them.
The end of Our Father in the Lord's Prayer is the top story in the Daily Mail. The Church of England is to explore the use of gender-neutral terms, which could see the Lord's Prayer opening line, Our Father, become Our Love.
The Star leads with evil killer's plot to snatch Justine. The man who abducted and killed Justine Valdez had carried out a practice run before the murder, a senior Garda believes.
The Sun leads with better late than never. Brian Tuberty has hit back at Eurosong critics and pleaded for the contest to remain on the Late Late Show.
The Examiner's front page, attacks on nurses a new low. A string of racist attacks on nurses outside a busy hospital has been described as a new low by the Taoiseach.
And finally, the Mirror leads with a similar story. Spat at, abused, stab threats. A paediatric nurse yesterday revealed she was threatened with being stabbed as she left work.
Joining us to discuss that story and more is News Talk's Andrea Gilligan. Andrea, thank you so much for joining us today. And I think the front page is attacks on nurses, a new low. And there was an Oireachtas committee meeting yesterday. It's perfect you're here today because this all started with one email that was sent into your show on Lunchtime Live. Yeah.
We got an email in about 7 or 8 weeks ago from a nurse, and a former nurse actually, asking us, just detailing her own experience, how her experience of bullying within the health service had been dealt with. And she subsequently left the working in the health sector and changed career. And she just asked us to chat about it on the programme just to see if anybody else had a similar experience. And we spoke to Kate on the programme, and to use that phrase, it opened the floodgates. It really did. More and more people continued that day to get in touch the following day. And in the days after, Tommy, the emails continued. They're still 7 or 8 weeks later continuing to come in. And this is people outlining bullying allegations, harassment claims, but more importantly, how they're dealt with. The feeling of not being heard, the feeling of not being supported, and everybody talking about this, about the culture that exists within the health service. Yeah. Toxic is the word that's so frequently used in all of these emails. So this was brought up before the Oireachtas Health Committee yesterday. It was a committee meeting that was taking place to look into the safety and well-being of frontline workers. The Sinn Féin TD, David Cullinan, brought it up at the committee hearing. And it really, I suppose, just detailed what is happening. We heard from all of the different unions yesterday. I was actually there at the committee meeting myself. The INMO, the IMO forces, SIPTU were all there to effectively, I suppose, confirm in many ways. But the testimonies that we had heard in recent weeks about the experience of people working in the health service. And, like, we talk time and time again about the pressures those working in the frontline sectors face between overcrowding, understaffing. Like, it's a highly pressurised job at the best of times. And if you put into that, you know, the fear of going to work, perhaps if you're somebody that's going through, you know, an experience of bullying, like, it's a really toxic cocktail and terrible pressure, people feeling extremely stressed, undervalued, and in so many cases, as I have found out in recent weeks, people are subsequently leaving the health sector over this.
Well, that's, I mean, it's no surprise. Look, my wife is a nurse in a GP practice, and she, I'm just reading this, where Sylvia Chambers, who is a nurse for 18 years, saying she's never experienced aggression like this. And that's the thing that I hear from my wife all the time. The people nowadays, there is just a lack of patience. People want stuff all the time. When they don't get it, there's just this aggression. And it's frustration with people out there. But what really strikes me then is, for you to go to your senior and try and explain this, that actually superiors are not listening to them when they're raising issues of management.
In some cases, Tommy, what we have heard in over the past number of weeks is that the very people that you are due to go to report, you know, like if Murrin, you know, will say is the head of the HR here and I'm having an issue with Murrin, like, it's Murrin that might be actually investigating my issue. And that, for so many people, not only is that a deterrent from you ever even reporting the issue, but, like, how, you know, you have to look, I suppose, and critically analyse where is the fair process and fair procedure in that. Yes, there are HSE policies there in place. The question, I suppose, is, are they robust enough to deal with the allegations that are coming through?
So this is happening in Oireachtas Health Committee, whereby it was an incident heard on your show on Lunchtime Live, and that was bullying within the organisation of the HSE. So that is something that people are dealing with in an organisation they work for. Then from outside the HSE, we see, and this is on the front of the Examiner today, 5,593 assaults on nurses and midwives alone between January 2021 and October of last year in public hospitals. And increasingly in Dublin, we're seeing nurses who are foreign nationals subject to racist attacks. Yeah. So that's just them trying to go to work. And then you've got people inside the workplace, members of the public, are assaulting them as they do their job, as Tommy said, that his wife is subjected to as well.
I heard Sylvia Chambers yesterday and her testimony, and it was extraordinary actually to listen to her. She spoke extremely well. She talked about, like, she's a nurse with over 18 years experience working in the paediatric field, and she talked about, you know, in one case she detailed a man, a grown man, like over 6 foot tall, a parent, you know, throwing objects at her. She talked about being threatened when she left work. She detailed, you know, being spat at, like all of the different kind of things that have happened to her and her colleagues. And she, as she said herself yesterday, I'm just going into work to do my job. I'm not going in to deal with you know, this sort of behaviour, this kind of aggression. No. She talked about, as you said, Tommy, the escalation in that aggression. And when she was asked yesterday, well, why has that increased? It's increased off the back, she said, that there's often only two doctors working from 2 a.m. to the early hours of the morning. You might have somewhere in the region of, she said, maybe 40 to 50 parents there with children, patients waiting to be seen. The parents are getting frustrated because, naturally, their care is for their kids.
It's the HSE that's broken, not the doctors or nurses who are trying to do their job.
And it's
love to hear from you on this.
Piles up the pressure.
Yeah, we'd love to hear from you on this, like whether you work in the health system or something that you've seen there, 0896 111 111. You can also use that number for our very next story in something that might be the most unsurprising news in politics ever. Bertie Ahern, 10 years after the Mahon Tribunal, he's rejoined Fianna Fáil.
Yeah, Bertie's back. Seemingly it happened in December, actually. He rejoined his local Cumann in the Dublin central area 10 years after he quit the party, as you mentioned, following the findings of the Mahon Tribunal back in 2012. Micheál Martin, the Taoiseach, confirmed this yesterday. He was asked about it. He said, you know, he felt it was now was the appropriate time for the former Taoiseach, Bertie Ahern, to re-enter the fold. And I suppose in light, too, of the forthcoming 25th anniversary of the Good Friday Agreement. That's coming up now in the next 2 months or so. There's going to be a huge amount of discussion, commentary, publicity, not to be cynical about it, around the 25th anniversary of the Good Friday Agreement. So Micheál Martin felt this was the right time for Bertie to come back.
Do you think this is all a plan, though, that he's running for the Áras in 2025?
Look, there's been huge speculation about this. I mean, Bertie was asked about it in recent months himself, and I think his line at the time, or his quote, was, when is that election again? Micheál Martin was asked about it yesterday, too. I mean, he said it's absolutely nothing to do with that. Hasn't been discussed. I mean, it's just a simple case of he wanted to, you know, to re-enter or come back to his Cumann. We don't need reminding. It was actually Micheál Martin who proposed Bertie Ahern be expelled back in 2012. Like, he ultimately quit himself, but it was Micheál Martin put forward that expulsion. Look, within the Fianna Fáil ranks, you know, a lot of people seem to be warmly welcoming his re-entrance back into the party fold. A lot of this, though, was around the 25th anniversary. Yeah. There's going to be huge discussion around it. Not to be cynical and think that it's all about the publicity that they're there.
Yeah, but he can do that. He can do that from with outside the party. I just wonder, Mary O'Callaghan or Bertie Ahern? Is that what's going to happen in 2025?
Let us know at 0896111111. Would you like to see Bertie
in the
for Michael Higgins? Let us know.
That's where the speculation has certainly ramped up.
Does he have a dog?
Well, he can get a few.
I think that's standard. You have to at least two, isn't it?
And you have to have at least
two. Miriam has dogs.
At least two. Andrea. There we go.
Oh, there we go. We've got the megaphone up and going as well. We'd love to hear from you. Would you like to see Bertie Ahern as the next presidential candidate? Get the camera up, scan the little corner, let us know. If Bertie's there, he's definitely going to be voting yes.
Morning, Bertie. Vote away. vote early, vote often.
Let us know. We'd love to hear from you on that. Thank you very much. Andrew Gilligan from Lunchtime Live. Congratulations on that story. Great work on that as well. Brilliant to have you with us.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Andrea. Alan, what's up next?
Well, Miriam, when we come back, we've got expert advice on how to navigate the world of mortgages. We'll see you shortly.
Now, I'm sure there's lots of people tuning in this morning going to be very interested in this, because securing a mortgage can be a minefield. But they're here to break it down is finance expert and founder of MoneySharper.ie, Mark Cohn. Good morning to you, Mark. We were chatting there about mortgage, and we are now in Europe the third lowest country to apply for a mortgage in the rate.
We are right now, actually. We do, for the first time in a long time, we do have the lowest interest rates in across Europe. But I don't think that's going to stay for long. I think it's a little bit that the banks have been a little bit caught cold. I would expect those rates to rise over the next few months.
Or normally the highest interest rate for mortgages.
So previously we've been the highest for about about 10 years. So I think things will revert to normal, but they're good at the moment.
Can we take it right back to the initial steps? Because these aren't things that we are taught in school. If there's someone at home and we're all sitting there, well, there's no point applying for a mortgage because I'm a single person, it's 3.5 times your salary. If you are going, right, at some stage, I'm going to have to apply for a mortgage, what do you need to do to prepare for it?
Yeah, well, I mean, it's really tough out there in the housing market at the moment. So the first thing I'd say is if you are looking at getting a property, then get your mortgage sorted as early as possible. And it's not actually as complicated as people might think. So the really important thing is, if a bank is going to lend you 200, 300,000 euro, the thing that they're concerned about, are they going to get their money back?
Yes,
So the real thing that you have to do is prove that you're good for the money. And really, there's two steps to prove that. The first is that you've got to have evidence that you've been putting aside regularly for 6 months before you apply enough to, if there was a mortgage, you'd be able to pay it. So you're saving each month about the amount
so
that you would be paying in your mortgage.
Do they have to see that in bank accounts and bank statements?
They do. Now, there is good news. If you're renting, though, that counts. Because obviously, if you're paying a rent, then it's really hard to say.
But are they going to look for more? Like, these days, we have got people from Limerick to Galway to Waterford to Dublin paying 1.5 to 2 grand to 3 grand a month on rent. Are they going to want to see that rent or see rent and savings?
Right. It only depends. For most people, the rent will be enough because, unfortunately, we've got the situation where the rents are actually higher than mortgage payments, right?
Yeah.
So that's probably enough evidence. If you do need to check what your mortgage is going to be, because if you're trading up to a lot bigger, then you might have a jump. So you may have to top up a little bit. But yeah, in theory, you could get it with no, you could get a mortgage with no savings. But that's the first thing. The second thing that I really encourage people to do is check out if they've got any skeletons in their cupboard in terms of credit. If there's anything around credit cards or loans. So there's the central credit register. So basically you apply to the central credit register. Just check if there's any red flags. What you don't want to do is apply and then find if you're buying with a partner,
had a bad credit rating in the past because of something that you didn't pay off and there's a black mark against your name.
Yeah, because that can actually kill your mortgage stone dead. So if you've got something outstanding, and it may be something you went off travelling when you were 18, 19 and you left a credit card unpaid, you know, a nominal amount, then it will be at least 2 years before you can actually apply for a mortgage. So get that sorted straight away.
It won't stand to you. Like, I do know lots of people who got credit cards when they were in first year in college, and my God, you know, there was issues and bailiffs and all that kind of stuff. So will that be gone? If you've paid it off and you've sorted it all out and it's 2 years later,
once you clear it,
two years
with certain lenders, some need 5. But the one thing that I would say to people is just check if there's nothing funny. And make sure if you're applying, you and your partner check.
Can I just ask, like, if that was like a couple of hundred quid that you didn't pay, is that going to stop you getting a mortgage?
It could mount up. The important thing is you get it sorted. If you get it sorted, the clock starts ticking. So those are the two gotchas, really. Make sure your repayments are happening. And your CCR.
Now, obviously, a deposit on a house or an apartment or whatever you're buying is the huge thing, but there are so many hidden extras then that you need to be able to pay for. What are they?
Yeah, so they do mount up, so you do have to make sure that you have enough to cover them. So the big one really is your solicitor. A mortgage is quite complicated. A house purchase is quite complicated. So you probably need to put aside between 2,000 to 2,500 for a solicitor. You will need to get your home independently valued. So even though you're buying the home, you will also need to get valued by the lender. That's about 200 euros. And if you're going through a mortgage broker, that can range from about 300 to about 300, 400 euros. So all in all, about 3,000 should about cover your additional costs.
Right.
OK, because I did one where I was trying to apply for it myself, and the next one I just went to a mortgage broker because I was like, I can't be dealing, because I just didn't get all the forms.
Well,
Not to push it on people. Like, people can definitely do it themselves, but you have to have the time to do it, right?
Well, I would say you're handling enough when you're buying a home, right, without worrying about the mortgage. So don't wreck your head with all the details of which interest rate, your documents. The brokers are paid to deal with this stuff and they're trained to deal with this stuff. And they actually get 1% of the mortgage and it doesn't cost you any more. So they're heavily subsidised to do work for you.
Yeah.
So let them. Why not use them?
Yeah. And what schemes are out there that people might avail of?
Yeah, so if you're buying a new home, there are some pretty good schemes. So on new build, you can get up to 30% of the cost of the home through two grants. There's the Help to Buy scheme, which gives you tax relief. So if you paid tax, you get your tax back.
Yeah.
And then the other big one is called the Home First scheme. And that the government effectively takes a chunk of your home, but it's free money, actually. So they're really good. So if you're doing, if you're buying
a chunk of your home, can you eventually buy them out?
You can buy them out, or when you sell, they take the money back. But it's a pretty good, I'd recommend that scheme. Okay. It's pretty good.
This is for new homes. Now, when you're saying that sounds so great, is there like thousands of people on these lists waiting for these homes because like they're only new homes and we know that not enough new homes are being built?
No, you're right, Alan. So these schemes have pushed up the prices in new homes a little bit.
Oh.
Now that does mean ultimately more new homes might get built, which I guess is the thinking behind the scheme.
Yeah.
But in the short term, there is a trade-off. There's more money, but the prices have gone up.
Really quickly, for people right now who are on tracker, it was always said over the years, never give up your tracker.
Yeah.
Obviously, we're in a situation where the European Central Bank is putting up interest rates. Should people be going out looking for a fixed mortgage and getting rid of their tracker?
Yeah, so for tracker customers, you really need to think about this now. So the actual cost of a tracker has gone up in just 8 months by $24,500. The average tracker over 15 years is up $24,500. The rate's gone on average from 1.15 to 4.65 in just 8 months. So the maths around that, Mirren, that's never give up your tracker.
Wow.
That whole logic has changed. So I'm saying to tracker customers, do two things. Number one, get a fixed offer letter from your bank. So phone your bank today, this week, get a fixed offer letter.
Okay.
That will tell you, if you fix with your current bank, how much you'd be able to fix on. And then take that letter, go to a broker, and the broker will talk you through your three options. So should you stick on your tracker? Because that might still be the best option, even though it costs more. Should you fix with your current lender?
Or should you switch
your mortgage and fix?
Totally.
Now, typically, it's about 6,000 less if you do the switch and fix. So it's definitely worth checking this stuff out with the broker.
Right.
Going to the broker today?
He's going to be checking that out. Mark Cohen from MoneySherpa.ie, thank you so much for coming
in and talking
to us. Hopefully that didn't dull. It's a lot, isn't it? Tommy, what have we got in the way?
Sure is, guys. On the way, we're going live to Turkey, where Irish aid worker Anne O'Rourke is seeing firsthand the fallout from the devastating earthquake over there. We'll see you very shortly. Now, as the death toll from the Syrian and Turkish earthquake passes 16,000 people, aid workers are scrambling to help those affected.
Anne O'Rourke is from Waterford, and in 2017 she made her way over to Greece and then on to Turkey to help set up a community centre and an aid camp, and she's doing what she can right now to get vital supplies to Syria. And Anne joins us now. Anne, thank you so much for joining us. I know that you have been doing lots of work for years, but can you tell me what it's like on the ground there right now as we're hearing these devastating numbers?
Yeah, it's dreadful. I have no words for it, to be honest with you. It's absolutely dreadful. A lot of the people that are under the rubble, even within the Turkish end of it, were refugees that had come across the border into Gaziantep and Reyhanlı and those areas. So you've got a huge amount of refugees that had escaped from Syria that are under this earthquake has affected, and also then you have the people within Syria as well. So it's a double whammy.
I mean, we're just seeing pictures and seeing reports mainly from Turkey. Given Syria's kind of geopolitical situation, you're trying to get supplies and things into Syria across the border. How are you managing to do that?
Well, first of all, Syria, we can kind of more or less say that there's two sections. There's the government section, which the government will look after during the earthquake or do whatever they can do. And then there's the north of Syria, which is where our main concern is. The north of Syria is more or less abandoned by everybody. There's no up to yesterday evening, there was absolutely no way of getting anything in, and I still don't think there's any way of getting anything in. So what we did was, first of all, Tiafi had the people working in Tiafi, or the volunteers, were all volunteers. They're mainly Syrian refugees. So that makes a massive difference in the sense that they know people in those areas. They have family and friends that are in Syria that they don't know if they're alive or dead, that they can contact. So that gives a great sense of urgency in Tiafi, and everybody is running around trying to do their best. So what we did yesterday, which was really good, is the evening we contacted four or five of the health centres in Syria, in Idlib, and asked them what was the situation. And they needed blood bags, they needed body bags, they needed catheters, syringes. So we got our list. But because we couldn't get anything into Syria, no medical stuff, no food, nothing, what we had to do was we had to try and find it within Syria and then get it brought to Idlib and then get it delivered to the hospitals, the small hospitals. So it was a huge team effort, but we did it. And it was great late last night to see some of the videos of the medical equipment arriving into some of these hospitals that are in desperate need at the moment. Plus food, nobody has food. So this morning we're trying to deliver food parcels to that area and blankets.
Because I think we know that crossing the border, there's only certain roads, of course, that can be used. A lot of those roads are impassable at the moment, and there is freezing conditions. And as you mentioned,
is this because controlled by the rebels at the moment?
There's only certain roads between Turkey and Syria that can be used.
What is it about?
Yeah, there is. Yeah, you see, the north. So, say for example, if you are not a fan of the regime, and you lived in Aleppo, you lived in some of those areas, there was a thing called the green bus. OK, and the green bus would pick you and your family up and take you from the government control area and bring you out to the country. And you'd live out in some anywhere, wherever they dropped you off, and you would have to make a living and get on with your life. So when we say rebel held areas, it does appear as if, you know, you're thinking this is all, you know, all these people out here are, you know, rebels. But actually an awful lot of the people out there are just people that don't agree, families, fathers, mothers that don't agree with the president.
Yeah.
So because of that, they have a shortage already of everything. Mm. So even up to last week, we were getting calls in Tiafi, you know, we have a family here in the north, we have no food, we have no water, we have no electricity. And then an earthquake. Mm. You know, it's insane, really. It's insane.
And as a result of that, obviously, working on the border there, you're doing everything you can in the northern areas, which are completely underfunded and people don't have anything, as you have mentioned.
Yeah.
Are you worried that the numbers that are coming out of Syria are grossly underestimated, that we're not getting the real figures about the people who have been affected?
Absolutely not. You definitely are not getting the real figures because we've 17,000 Arabic, or we 17,000 followers on our Arabic followers on our Facebook page. So we have huge access. We get so much information from within Syria, right? And you know, we spoke to somebody in a small enough town the other day, and they said that they believe there's about 2,000 within that small area under the rubble, but there's nobody coming to take them out. There's nobody, there's no rescue teams coming in. There's no, you know, you have no heroes coming in to help them. They are very much abandoned, very much on their own. Tiafi is a very small organization. As I said, we're all volunteers. So we have to find out how we can make the most impact with the money we have.
So,
and that's what we felt in that area, get medical supplies in. And I mean, this probably sounds ridiculous, but I didn't buy the body bags because I thought buy the blood bags. It's better to save the people,
yeah.
You know, and that's the kind of decisions we have to kind of look at. How can we, you know, how can we help as best we can, and how can we spend the money, the donations we have, as carefully as we can?
Yeah.
But then there's an impact, a huge impact then as well, towards in all the other cities now, because they're bussing people out of the Turkish end of it, into other cities. So Tiafi will be already, it's inundated with people looking for food and help, because there's an 89% inflation rate.
I mean, it's incredible to think you're having to make the decision whether to buy blood bags or body bags. But listen, as we can see, the website is below there, tiafi.org. If people want to get online to donate to the great cause, of course, it is a non-profit organisation. You're doing amazing work over in Turkey and Syria at the minute. And thank you so much for talking to us this morning, Anne O'Rourke.
Amazing what Anne is doing. If there's anything you can do, they're also on Facebook, and Anne is getting that money and she's spending it directly within Syria, so you know where your money is going if you decide to donate to her.
Plenty more Ireland M coming up after this.
It's time now to take a look at this morning's papers. We'll start with the Irish Times. Its headline: Erdogan criticised as earthquake death toll climbs above 16,000. President Recep Tayyip Erdogan has visited the region of southern Turkey devastated by this week's earthquake, and we are now learning that the numbers have surpassed 16,000.
Electricity firms in hot water over false 100% green claim. That's the front page of the Irish Independent. Electricity companies are misleading hundreds of thousands of customers by claiming to supply 100% renewable power. An advertising watchdog investigation has found.
The Herald goes with the life was gone out of Cullum's eyes. A Garda has described the moment he rolled over a gunshot victim to discover it was his colleague, Garda Cullum Horkin, telling a jury his eyes were still open but the life had gone out of them.
The end of Our Father in the Lord's Prayer is the top story on the Daily Mail. The Church of England is to explore the use of gender-neutral terms, which could see the Lord's Prayer opening line, Our Father, become our love.
The Star leads with evil killer's plot to snatch Justine. The man who abducted and killed Justine Valdez had carried out a practice run before the murder, a senior Garda believes.
The Sun leads with better late than never. Ryan Tuberty has hit back at Eurosong critics and pleaded for the contest to remain on The Late Late Show.
The Examiner's front page: attacks on nurses a new low. A string of racist attacks on nurses outside a busy hospital has been described as a new low by the Taoiseach.
And finally, the Mirror leads with similar story. Spat at abused stab threats. A paediatric nurse yesterday revealed she was threatened with being stabbed as she left work.
And unsurprisingly, we've got messages on the healthcare sector.
Jennifer says, just on the topic of issues of healthcare, there is far more verbal abuse now. On dental practices also, a lack of tolerance and patience among many dental patients. Frustrations are existing because of massive shortages of dentists, leading to dentists being overstretched, fewer dentists treating patients on medical cards, and a lot of reasons leading to further stress on the health system. So we're saying nurses, but like, you never think dentists as well, dealing with people every day. They're just getting abuse as well.
And it's hard to get it because more and more dentists are going into Botox and actually leaving dental work.
Yes.
So it's like there's a huge shortage.
You understand why people just are just fed up with it.
Absolutely.
The pandemic, the pressure that they're put under, the shortage of staff, and then to be getting abused on top of that.
Yeah.
You know, it's no surprise at all.
And we were talking to Andrea Gilligan, who began Lunchtime Live talking about bullying within the HSE organisation itself, and it led to an Oireachtas committee. So fair play to Andrea for doing that. Donna said, I used to work in a HSE nursing home. I have since left. I loved my job and I loved working with my residents. Unfortunately, some of the work colleagues were less than desirable. I used to be sick of the thoughts of going to work over who I would be working with on the day. There is no accountability. The ones causing the problems are the very ones running to the office at every beck and call.
Isn't that crazy? Isn't that, imagine that you're sort of sick to the pit of your stomach going in thinking, oh, who am I going to be faced with today?
Yeah.
That's shocking.
Yeah.
No support. That's it.
There's also another story we're talking with Andrea Gilligan as well, is that Bertie Ahern is back. Bertie's back,
I
baby.
I think Bertie'd make a good president.
Do you think so?
Yes.
Well, this said, we put it up on our megaphone to ask people, what do you think? Would you like to have Bertie as your presidential, as your next president after Michael D. Higgins?
67 said no.
69% said no.
69.
So we have a message in here from somebody saying, I would, as a Fianna Fáil voter all my life, never support Fianna Fáil again if they welcome Bertie Ahern back.
And Claire says Bertie would
make
me
absolutely ashamed of himself. I'm very disgusted and appalled voter.
We should just say that Bertie is back. He's been welcomed back into the Fianna Fáil fold. So he's been back since December as a Fianna Fáil voter. We're just talking about, could he be running for the president? Because it always seemed like that's kind of what he wanted.
Well, Claire says Bertie would make a great president. He has statesmanship and there's no one else. He's an obvious choice.
There you go. Hold your little
put your camera
the corner,
up and vote there, Claire. We'll,
69%, 68% say no at the moment. Interesting to see what we'll get that at 9:15.
Do you think he'd make a good president?
Well, let people decide.
Okay, it's time for a quick break now. After this, we're going to catch up with the Irish rugby legend Shane Byrne and the Mullet. They're both here. We'll see you
They're both minute. Here.
They're Byrne. Both here. The Mullet's here as well.
Welcome back. Now, our next guest is known for his talent on the rugby field. Hairdressers everywhere want to get their hand on him. And most recently, his unexpected dancing skills.
We are here to talk to us about the move from scrum to stage. It's the rugby legend, of course, Shane Byrne. Good morning to you, Shane.
Good morning, guys.
Great. Hello.
Are you with us?
Yes, how are you?
How long did it take to just... It just happens. It just falls into place like that, doesn't
there.
It?
There.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's an old towel, brush, grand. Done.
Can we... I want to get on to rugby, but you... Right. There is a story that you once got dropped from the team because you wouldn't cut the hair. Is that like...
Twice.
Believe it?
Yeah, I don't believe that. Who dropped
Noisy
you?
Murphy.
Noisy Murphy.
Yeah, yeah. Basically, coming off the plane in 94 at Australia, probably the last great amateur tour.
Yeah.
And well done, great tour. Thank you very much. Get your hair cut. No. Gone.
So was it a lot longer?
No.
Or was it like just the mullet?
For sure, you're only a chap at the time. But like back in the 90s, it was all about the shaved heads and the tight haircuts. And that wasn't exactly what I was.
The Keith Woods of the world.
Well, he was a bit follically challenged. He was having a different issue.
He could only dream of the mullet.
But you were, because I was saying that at the time, he was like, no way.
Sure,
get dropped
and
for
then
that.
95, the Six Nations subbed against Wales. And same again, gone.
The hair.
For the hair.
Yeah. Yeah.
Did no one ever said anything to you about your blonde tips?
Well, the blonde tips are very in at the time, you see, Byrne. Not quite like the mullet. See, the mullet's all in now.
No, they weren't, Tom. They were never in.
Yeah, but they were never in. But you're listening, you've got to believe what you think. Listen, how are you getting on? What did you make of the performance of the weekend? I mean, listen, it's a pretty good time to be a supporter of Irish rugby at the minute.
It's absolutely fantastic. And, you know, even now there's a couple of injuries and stuff like that. And there's a calmness. Mm-hmm. The step down doesn't seem to be as far as it used to be. And we can, like, imagine, like, no Tig Furlongs and... You know, Henshaw's, normally we'd be panicking.
Yeah.
And we're not. This squad, the way they came out against Wales was just fantastic. But that's the key to this now. Like, it's gas in round two. We're already talking about this is the deciding game against France. We've been doing very high-profile things, getting up to the number one seed in the world. France have been doing pretty much the same, very, very quietly in the background. They're seeded number two in the world. So they're going to be our major competition for the Six Nations and the World Cup to come. But if Ireland go out and start the way they did against Wales, that's the key.
Because it was... See, it's interesting where I might, like, as a supporter, think it's nice to be the underdog when it comes to Ireland. And a lot of the chat after the Autumn Internationals was, oh, France are really number one. Like, they should be ahead of us. But when you see, you know, Entermax performance and all that kind of stuff and how France played against Italy, which is the surprise that I've seen in the tournament for such a long time, it's certainly going, well, this is ours to lose.
Well, there's two things to that. Italy are going to take beating this year. I think they've actually improved. So you're going to have to beat them. So you can't take away from what they did there. But France never settled. So Ireland's big opportunity now is to keep that unsettledness. Don't allow them to settle. When they come over here, when the game starts... On Saturday, don't allow them to settle. Start as strong as they did against Wales and just don't let France get into the game. That's going to be key because, listen, we've got, I know it's nearly the dirty word, we've got that World Cup coming up, we've a hoodoo we need to get over.
Yeah.
You and I have both have been in a few.
Both been
I've got the quarterfinals.
Yeah.
And the key is, like, we've got to do what England did the last time. They went down to New Zealand in the summer before.
Yeah.
Won down there, clean sweep the November Nationals, and then they beat us here for a Grand Slam, and they had a really successful Six Nations. That's what we realistically have got to do.
Yeah.
We have to have a good Six Nations. I don't know if there's a Grand Slam in it this year, but definitely a championship.
Listen, exactly. You have to keep ticking the boxes,
correct,
and that's what Andy Farrell is doing. Tadhg Furlong's not there. Doesn't matter. Opportunity for somebody else. And
yeah.
I actually think that Ireland are... they're relishing the chance of not being underdogs anymore. And that's with the leadership of Andy Farrell. He's always been one of the best players, one of the best teams. Johnny Sexton, Leinster the same. And I think that it's a case of relishing it, enjoying it. It's going to be a cracker this weekend.
Psychologically, they do, like, you're looking at them.
Yeah.
Going, they're up for it.
This is bring it on.
That squad, they're a different animals. Like, they really are. The favourite tag sits very lightly on them.
Well,
like, if you look at Doris, etc., these guys, Keenan, like, they're just playing out of their skins.
Fabulous.
Why would you always play to be the best in the world and when you get there you want to give it away? You have to appreciate while you're there. Listen, we have to talk about what's going on at the weekends. You're not getting to watch any of the rugby at all. You're actually skipping training, I believe.
Coach Karen's not happy.
So, Dancing with the Stars you're doing at the moment.
Yes.
Is it actually 5 hours training every day?
Yeah, you'd be talking minimum. I normally get up to Dublin around this
time. I'm watching you and it doesn't look like it's 5 hours training.
Well, Tommy, I'm just saying most of it is instruction. It's not all leaping around the place. Thank you very much.
You are.
There's a very brave man over there. Yeah.
He's unbelievable. Shout 10 siblings
I'll
out of
him. I'll have a chat with him after.
Oh, look at you go.
Well, you deserve a 10 for that one. But how are you finding it?
I tell you what, it's great fun. It's great fun. And Karen does amazing choreography and the dances have been fantastic. It's something that I didn't think I'd enjoy as much as I am now. And the one thing, you remember the buzz we get before, just before you're going onto the pitch.
Yeah.
That buzz is there again for this. And now the difference is that we were supposedly good at getting onto the rugby pitch.
Yeah.
This, I'm still, it's completely outside the comfort zone. So that adds to it. But it's great fun. It really is. It's really enjoyable.
It's also, I believe that your wife is, not only your daughter's delighted you're doing this, but
yes,
your wife is like, she doesn't care about the Strictly curse. She's like, no, it's fine, take him away.
I don't know whether that's an insult or a compliment.
I think it's a bit of an insult.
Yeah, yeah. You know, you're grand. Shane will be grand. So, what the hell? Like?
Thanks. Cheers.
And even worse than that, it was Karen who she hoped I would get.
And she ended up with her former partner, Jake.
Oh, yeah.
Do you know? And your wife was like, yeah, fine.
No, my wife is not a bother.
Have you got a love for the dancing, though? Like, were you a dancer? I can't really remember you hitting the dance floor back in the day.
I didn't mind leaping around the dance floor. You know what I mean?
On.
But listen, it's not about leaping around the dance floor or even learning routines. It's all about how you put your hands and the toes have to be this way and your head has to be that way, even though you're going this way. It's like a totally different set of rules. Every single dance, and think of the hardness of it, you learn a dance, everything you do is all about that Sunday night, and then Etch-a-Sketch, it's gone. Monday morning, you're doing a completely different dance, new set of rules. I can't even remember. I couldn't tell you the dances I've done.
Do you find the nerves the same? Because, like, you've played in front of 50, 60, 70,000 people. But this is, you know, a small crowd, just the cameras. Like, is it...
just the cameras. And the nation.
Yeah, but is...
I know.
But do you put that in your mind or is that in the back of your head?
No, it's there. Okay. I tell you, it's caught me on the hop.
Okay.
I'd be pretty chilled out about stuff. I don't get stressed that much at all. But I found myself just... as you're running into it, you're going, oh, my God, Craig, what's the next step? And you're like, oh, yeah, OK, you're fine. Like, that you're really, you know, not panicking, but that you're inside your mind questioning, going, God, do I know this? Have I got this?
Is it nice, though? Because you are, there's always the fan favourites who everyone's kind of like going, what the hell are they going to be like? And it
what's
is,
what's the dumpy
like,
round lad going to be like?
When you started doing the cartwheels, everyone's like, Shane Byrne is doing cartwheels. Like, that's got to be nice, isn't it? That people are at home willing you to do
it. Well, the one thing that has been fantastic is the reaction we've had.
Yeah.
You know, the judges haven't necessarily reacted the best, but The people, firstly, who are in the crowd there have absolutely had a ball with what we've done. And as I said, Karen does amazing dances. But the reaction out and about, everybody knows exactly what's going on. Like, it's reaching far and wide.
Oh, it's brilliant. It really is brilliant. I finally just have to... How are you finding the spray tans?
Yeah, that's a bit...
Forgot about that.
That's a bit traumatic.
Tell you the truth. How are you getting it off?
Huh?
How are you getting it off?
How'd you get it off? They just top it up, like.
Oh, do you?
Yeah, oh, you get another one, like.
You've got a healthy glow here this morning.
Oh, thank you very much.
Do they spray everywhere? There we go. Okay.
That's a little pants, if you're honest. Yeah. We don't need
good
to
do morning. That.
Good morning, television.
Good morning.
Shane Byrne, it's a pleasure to have you with us. Pleasure. And all the very best. What are you dancing this weekend? Do we know who you like?
Davini's Waltz.
Ooh. Ooh, graceful, Shane.
First. Slowish one we've done, yeah.
Can't do a cartwheel with that one.
Come on, you'd be surprised. You'd be surprised.
If you would like, of course, the huge weekend this weekend, if you would like to have been with a chance with two tickets to see Ireland versus France this Saturday, they are absolute gold dust.
You can't, I'm looking for a pair of tickets if there's anyone that would help me out. To be with a chance to win, all you've got to do is get in touch on our WhatsApp number. It's 0896111111 and answer this question. Who won the Grand Slam at last year's Six Nations? It's as simple as that. You have to be available to speak with a member from the Ireland AM team by 1 p.m. or they will go to a runner.
The very best of the luck with that. Shane, great to have you with us again.
Thanks for staying with us. Now, it's National Pizza Day, so guess what we're making in the kitchen?
Oh. Guess. Chef Alberto Rossi is here with the perfect Italian staple, pizza.
Very good. Good morning, Tommy, and good morning, Alan. So, pizza, International Pizza Day. It should be pizza day every day, not just today.
You know, like pizza.
If it's done correctly, pizza is fantastic, you know? Mm-hmm. And what people always ask me is, like, with all these pizzas, how come Italians are not a bit bigger?
Yes.
Because you don't need to eat a pizza big like this, you know?
But it's a small one. Like, Tommy has already started, so I'm going to start. No, I've actually had...
One.
I took two slices and I pushed it back together.
Exactly, pretending it didn't happen.
So, but there's a difference between... pizza in Italy, I think, and when I was in Rome a couple of weeks ago, it was just a different
level. Yeah, because you have two kinds of pizza. They call it pizza romana, that is a little bit thinner, and then you have the Napolitan pizza, that's a bit the one with all the bubbles and everything. You know, it also depends on how it's cooked. Okay. It's a wooden oven, or it's a normal oven, like it would have a tone, so it makes all such a difference, you know?
Now we have to focus here.
Yes,
now.
We have to focus. You know? Thank you, Nikki, for spreading my secret out. You know?
What?
Focus.
Okay.
With no accent. That took a lot of power. So pizza. Pizza, I'm not saying it's easy, because, you know, but it's easy enough to make.
Yeah, come on,
because you only have flour, water, olive oil, yeast, and salt. Okay, and you put it in the mixer and you just mix, and it comes like a very nice dough that then you have to shape and put in a container and you have to proof for about 3-4 hours. Okay.
Okay, so you don't put it overnight. You kind of
can do it overnight too. Like, let's say if you work as a professional pizzaiolo, you can decide what amount of yeast you're gonna put based on when do you need it. You know, for example, years ago I was working in this restaurant, the guy prepared it the night before. So he put a little bit of yeast, put it in the fridge, so the yeast goes to sleep. Then you bring it out, the heat makes it boom. Okay. But if you're making it at home, let's say Sunday, I'm gonna make home pizza for the kids. Mm-hmm. So at about 11, I'm gonna start to make this mix.
Okay.
You know, and the first dough that comes out is this.
Yeah.
You put, cover, I put it in the cupboard, you know, so it's nice and warm. You know,
the what?
The cupboard.
The cupboard.
You know, where the heat is, in a nice hot pile. Yeah. So it proofs, it raises, okay? And then you have to take it back and you're gonna make single pizza balls.
Okay.
You know, these are about 100, 120 grams each, you know, because what happens is you're gonna proof the big one, then make it smaller, so then you have portions.
Can we see you cooking something?
Absolutely. So now I have the pizza. Dough here.
Can I just say, those little balls are about 250 grams.
Well, 120 grams.
Sorry?
120 grams,
so
about.
Okay. Okay.
And that's after being in the cupboard for how long?
Well, first you go 3 hours with these, and then this one another couple of hours. You see them coming up twice the amount, you know, and that will mean it's ready.
But you can just go to the supermarket and buy a base.
Oh, yeah, but what's the fun in that, yeah. You know?
OK, come on. Come on, keep it going.
So then you have the pizza, and, you know, I'm not a pizzaiolo, so I do my best to make it look the way it should, OK? But sometimes I fail. So you can always use, you know, a rolling pin and make different shapes. You know, like when I do it with the kids at home, I always try to make it a little bit rectangular, a little bit different color, different shapes. Then I have the sauce. Now, the sauce, it's another very important part, because a lot of people think it's just tomato sauce. Mm-mm. But tomato sauce usually is cooked. Yeah. So here is just the peeled tomatoes in a can, the crushed ones, OK? You just open it, put it in a bowl, put a nice little bit of olive oil, OK?
So tinned tomatoes.
Tinned tomatoes, but the crushed one, not crushed the old ones, OK?
Chopped
then you
tomatoes.
Put tomatoes, you put a little bit of salt.
Olive oil.
Olive oil and basil. I just break it up. Okay. And you have a nice sauce like this. It's quite thick.
And no garlic.
No garlic. Garlic will take over everything. You know, once you put garlic in it, that's it. Unless you want a pizza with garlic, and then you put it, you know. But it's easy peasy, you know. And then you put your tomato sauce around.
And did you chop down that basil, obviously?
I broke it with my hands.
Okay.
You know, like this. You just break it so you have nice pieces so they come through. Okay.
So.
And then you have the mozzarella. Mozzarella, again, very important. You can get
good mozzarella.
Good mozzarella. You know, the one that you buy in the shops already grated, it's fine. Okay, but if you can buy the block and grate it yourself, it will be even better, okay?
Okay.
So then we go pizza. In this case, we just make a normal margherita, okay, in this case, you know? But then I made another one earlier that is a little bit different, okay?
But so what toppings do you like?
I like a bit of
pizza in the Intercontinental, do you?
We do. In room service, we sell pizza, you know? Oh, look at me. I broke the pizza.
Oh, a bit of a salad.
But look, you see, I say it's easy, but it's not easy. We serve pizza in the Intercontinental.
There's our pizza. This is Alberto's special. There's a hole in the middle.
But you've got a pizza stone, isn't that what it is?
We do a pizza stone. I brought this from home.
That's really important.
Very important. What you do, you need to make it hot.
Heat that up really hot.
Exactly.
So it kind of sticks. It cooks the underneath of the pizza, isn't it?
Because that's how a pizza oven works, you know, as the top, a dome like that. But the bottom is like about 300 degrees. And then at the top, you have 500 degrees. So you cook it from under, and then you cook it from the top.
What's your favorite topping? So there's all the toppings that you have.
Yeah, these are all the toppings. Yes, I like a bit of everything. Just as I said before, no pineapple, nothing, no fruits on my pizzas. Okay, people, that's how it is. And then you take a slice. There you go. You know.
Oh, it's roasting.
But this one has onion, some tomatoes, you know, and some mushrooms, you know. Keep it easy peasy.
And onions as well, I see.
Exactly.
Alberto Rossi, focus. Thank you very much.
Focus, I didn't focus enough. I made the hole in the pizza.
You weren't focusing enough.
Thank you very much.
No problem. Alberto. Enjoy.
Coming up, if you're watching the TV show The Last of Us and wondering, could this actually happen? Well, stay tuned. We're going to find out after the break.
Welcome back. It is one of the world's most talked about TV shows. The Last of Us depicts a post-apocalyptic America that has been ravaged by a fungal zombie virus. I haven't seen it yet, but I'm going to start to watch it this weekend. Coronation Street soon.
But is the show science fact or science fiction? Let's take a quick look.
If I'm taking you with me, you do what I say when I say it. Got any advice on the best way west?
Yeah, go east. You've come this far, and you know what's out there.
You're not gonna scare us.
Scared him?
You have a greater purpose than any of us could have ever imagined.
Be careful who you put your faith in.
You might not be her father, but you were someone's.
You trust me?
That's the fungus.
There.
I was wondering.
It's taken over. It's taken over. It's host. Please welcome. It's a really good show, by the way. Please welcome Professor of Microbiology at Maynooth University, Kevin Kavanagh. It's lovely to have you here,
lovely.
Kevin.
Thank you.
Little did you know you'd be discussing a video game that has been turned into the most watched TV show of the moment. They do a really good job at the very start of the show of explaining how this could happen.
Yeah.
So we've just come through a pandemic. So the epidemiologists have been doing all of this for a micro. What exactly is a fungus and how does it take over hosts?
Okay. So a fungus is a microbe, a very simple microbe. It can grow in the soil. It can grow in food and contaminate food and so on. The show depicts one particular type of fungus called a cordyceps, which in the tropics attacks insects, grows in their bodies, takes over their brains and eventually changes their behaviour and bursts out of their bodies. Now, the idea in the show is that this fungus has undergone a mutation that it can attack humans, grows in humans, develops, begins to change their behaviour and then eventually bursts out of their bodies, out of their brains. Now, we know what this group of fungi do in insects, for sure. Could that happen in humans? Extremely unlikely. So we're safe from that, I think.
You think so? That's incredible. So it actually does take and bursts out.
Out of the insect,
Is there something about the way it communicates? It's like a complicated way it communicates as well.
Exactly, indeed. When the fungus infects the insect, it doesn't want to kill the insect outright because if the insect died on the ground, its spores wouldn't spread in the environment. So it keeps the insect alive and then it manipulates its brain and makes it want to climb up a twig or a stem or some high structure and then it locks it into place. So the insect then will never move again. The fungus grows inside and eventually bursts out. So it manipulates it for its own end, to reproduce.
Because then the spores go out and it can infect other insects
exactly,
that are lower lying.
Indeed, yeah.
So it's a zombie insect.
Exactly.
It has been taken over.
It has.
The show posits, it puts forward this explanation that if the world got warmer, that the fungi would then from an evolutionary sense, they would change and they could look for warmer hosts, such as ourselves.
Right,
so it brings it back to climate change.
Exactly.
Could it happen?
Yes and no. Would this fungus be able to cause the types of conditions we see in the show in humans? No, because we've a very much more developed immune system compared to an insect. Our immune systems would catch this and kill it quite rapidly. However, we do know that in the last less than 10 years, new fungal pathogens have appeared that we never saw before. And one in particular is a yeast, and it was first seen in intensive care units on 5 different continents within a 6-month period. Never seen as a pathogen in humans before, and then in 2016, almost simultaneously in these 5 different locations. And we know that the one thing about it is it needs a higher temperature to become a pathogen. So we've seen an example where a new pathogen has emerged in humans and is now a major problem in hospitals. So yes and no, the temperature is going to increase the incidence of fungi becoming pathogens.
That's fascinating.
Yeah.
You're a microbiologist. Shows like this and with science, it's amazing for people actually for young people who kind of want to get an interest in this as well. And certainly hearing some of the things that you're coming out with, it's fascinating.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Now, the show certainly presents a very interesting, possibility.
Yeah.
Not a definitive, but a possibility.
Yeah.
On the other hand, we know fungi do so much for us.
Positive things.
Okay. Like they're making alcohol in beer, they're making bread. You know, the pizza dough is made by yeasts. You saw the pizza dough rise.
Make antibiotics. It's a fungi,
isn't it? It's a fungi, exactly.
Okay.
And it makes the dough rise. They make antibiotics. They do so many beneficial things for us.
Yeah.
If you think of all the leaves that fell off the trees in the autumn, they're all gone because fungi have broken them down, and then the new trees, new leaves will grow, and they will recycle. So they're very good. There's a small group that are bad, but most are very good.
Which is, they make the world turn. They're so important, like the bees. But also, when you mentioned that new pathogen that showed up in five different continents and people were in intensive care units.
Yes.
Yeah.
Are they better? Like, did they find what was wrong with them? Did they neutralise the fungi?
No. It's now one of the major pathogens in intensive care units. And the mystery is, where did this come from?
Yeah.
So we previously knew that this yeast, which is called, its name is Candida auris, because auris refers to the ear.
Yeah.
It was first found causing ear infections in intensive care units, which fungi generally don't do. So it was an unusual presentation. We now know that before in humans, it was seen in wild birds.
Wow.
So somewhere it jumped from
avian flu.
Wild birds into humans. And the higher temperatures have allowed that to happen.
It's just fascinating stuff. Listen, Kevin Kavanagh, thank you so much, of course, from the Maynooth University. Thank you so
much. Thank you very much.
For coming in.
Thank you.
That's blown my mind.
Back with you shortly on Ireland AM. I know, like... What?
Definitely the one.
Welcome back to Ireland AM. Lots of messages coming in. We were talking earlier on about what's going on in the HSE and the Oireachtas Committee, which is discussing the abuse that is being thrown at HSE workers, people who work in the healthcare systems, and the bullying from within the system as well. Orla says, we were in A&E a couple of years ago with a complication just 2 weeks after my husband's operation. It was packed, screaming and shouting and cursing. Started with a guy who was high. There were some really sick older people there, and everyone was really scared. He was obviously a regular as a nurses and security guy, knew his name. I can remember the frightened face of a little old man in the bed opposite of him who looked really sick having to listen to this behaviour. I do not know how the staff deal with this every single day and night. They are amazing.
Yeah. And it's true. I was in an A&E a while back as well, a couple of years ago. And the same thing, a couple of drunk guys, and the staff knew them by their name. The minute they came in, they went,
regulars.
Just regulars who just come in all the time.
Philomena just said, I worked in GP practice and the abuse from people when we had no available appointments. People should stop and think of those on the front line. We are just doing our best. And unfortunately, there's just such a shortage out there. And they are trying to do their best.
And I understand.
You can see the frustration.
Yeah, I do understand that with the frustration, because I was trying to get a blood test before Christmas and the first available blood test was like the 16th of January. And I was literally going to the girl. I said, the 16th of January, like, that's about 4 weeks away. Yeah. Like, how... Like, if you were worried about something. And she says, well, if you're worried, we'd put you up the list and stuff like that. But I was just going... Like, I can understand people being frustrated.
And
but I didn't take it out on the girl. I was just trying to question why it was taking so long.
Another text in here from Maria. So I saw Alan Hughes there in the GP print. Absolutely losing his mind at the staff. We'll read that one later. We're also talking about...
we're going to ring you back. Will you come on and talk to us about it on Monday? Your traumatic Alan Hughes experience.
The weekend crew will probably cover that one. Bertie's back in Fianna Fáil, and the talk is that he potentially could be going to replace Michael D. Higgins. Is that the plan? Potentially. So we just thought we'd ask, would you like to see Bertie as the next president of Ireland? And... 31%, only 31% of people have said yes. 69% said no.
I wonder why.
Wow.
Why is he disliked among our viewers this morning? Or why do they not think
right,
you should? Well, I
can
know.
Can you remember the Mahon Tribunal?
I know, but come on, politicians. Listen, and what they've done in the past.
Well, anyway, thank you all for getting involved in that, and thank you all for your texts as well. Coming up after the break, let's move on. From Titanic to Magic Mike's Last Dance, Brian Lloyd's going to be here to talk about the movies. See you soon.
Back. Strippers, stalkers, and sinking ships. Why am I saying these words in such an upbeat way? Because we're talking about movies, Brian Lloyd has nothing but the best for you to watch this weekend. Hello, Brian.
Hey.
Yeah, it's good. It's upbeat.
It is upbeat. I mean, after the guy that basically predicted the end of the world, they're like, I was watching that. Terrified.
Our microbiologist, Kevin.
Fascinating, isn't it?
Wow, like, fascinating. It really is fascinating. But I'm, like, going home and rethinking my life. So.
Yeah, it's the whole thing of, oh, my God, if I have children, they're going
to
take over my
But you know what? You don't have to think about it, because the first movie, you love this one.
Let's take a look at some strippers. Here's Magic Mike's Last Dance.
Come with me to London. Let's go. So
are you in London?
I'm gonna put on a show at this famous theater.
People are numb, disconnected. We're gonna wake them up with a wave of passion they've never felt before.
Hell yeah.
Without further ado, I give you the visionary artist Magic Mike.
So.
He's back.
Yeah. You gonna share what you were telling us off air with everybody?
My wife loves Magic Mike.
She does. Okay, yeah. So basically, Magic Mike's Last Dance is actually partly inspired by the Magic Mike live show, which is in London, and it was in Miami as well, I think. So essentially what's going on here is Mike, played by Channing Tatum, has essentially retired. He had a furniture business, but that imploded during the pandemic. He runs into Salma Hayek Penault now, because that is the thing.
When you're a billionaire, take the name.
Wouldn't you? Yeah. You're taking everything else. So, so she's this wealthy socialite who is recently divorced.
Ah.
Interestingly, yeah. And is trying to come up with a way to get back at her ex-husband. And the part of the story is that she's taken over this theatre in London, decides to revamp this kind of stuffy sage play by throwing in a load of male strippers, as you do.
Mm-hmm.
And she wants Magic Mike to choreograph and direct the whole show. This was great for the first, I would say, half hour, because it's basically Salma Hayek Penault and Channing Tatum grinding up against each other. And wow. Let me tell you, wow.
Wow.
If we could find the technology to harness that sexual chemistry,
really?
We could provide clean, renewable energy for decades to come. That's how strong it is. That's how powerful it is.
Is it that good? Well done.
It is like just, yeah, it's amazing.
Until
they go to London, and then it basically turns into a process story where it's like, how did they put on the show? How did they direct it? How did they convince everyone? And then they are not doing the bumping and the grinding, and you're just waiting for them to do the bumping and the grinding. And then it only happens in the third act, and then it's like, come on, like, we've waited the entire time to get there. It's fun. It's enjoyable. It's a good night out. I mean, I've seen all three of them, and they're all very, very entertaining.
Okay.
No, I've seen them all for work. I mean, I'm not.
Hey, the lady does protect.
No, I mean, like, I haven't watched it, but if my wife wants to take me, it's one for both. Like,
oh yeah,
it's a good, decent story.
It's a good crack. Yeah, it's very funny. Like, it's actually very, very funny. Like,
send the kids to Monon.
Yeah, exactly.
Just, you know, have the baby on and just.
Day night.
Yeah.
The kids are going to Monon. How many stars?
Chemistry between them two.
3 out of 5.
3 out of 5. That's pretty good. That's pretty good. We're going to move on to a TV show now.
Yeah.
This is called You. It's on Netflix. It's moving on to season 4. Honestly, I didn't get it, and then I watched it properly. It's so funny. Let's take a look at You.
Professor Jonathan Moore. Why are you here? Did you kill someone?
Or did someone break your heart?
Did you break my heart, Marianne? I walked along
the avenue. Heartbreak is always a catalyst for a new path.
You're a murderer, Joe.
You're wrong about me. I'm gonna prove it to you.
Okay, so what season 4? Like, is it getting a bit dated? This, like, what's the whole series?
It's basically just revamping the entire series. So essentially, what happened at the end of the third season? I'm not giving this away, because if you watch
it, happens in every series.
Sure.
Yeah.
Essentially, he's on the run now, and he's gone to London. He's assumed a new identity. He's working in the college.
He's
like this love bomber, stalker, serial killer kind of.
Professionally.
He's very, very good at it, because he survived for 3 seasons. But yeah, now he's in London, and he kind of falls in with this group of very, very wealthy people who are all terrible, because of course they are.
Yeah.
And then somebody dies, and then the person tries to frame him for it discovers his secret identity, and then the first like four episodes are him trying to puzzle it all out. That's part one. Part two gets released in March, where I presume the payoff is. I think you have to watch this show, as you say, like it's a comedy, because if you try to watch this seriously, you will just end up pulling your hair because it's so badly written,
yeah,
it's so clunky, it's so terrible. You kind of have to watch it as this is actually just some high concept comedy.
This is what I discovered when I tried. Yeah. I was like, this is really terrible. The subject matter, which is stalking, is yeah, so bad. And I was like, what's going on here? And someone said to me on Instagram, watch it like it's a comedy. Watch yeah, it like they're making a farce out of the fact that stalking
is going
on in the world.
Why would you watch it then?
Like, I mean, that's in fairness, it's if you didn't watch it, like this is my first time watching it, and I was like, this is terrible. And then I did exactly as you did, which is watch it as a comedy. I was like, okay, this is kind of fun.
There's so much stars better. Did you give it?
1.5 out of 5. Yeah. It's terrible. Yeah. Like, it is terrible.
Okay.
It is terrible. So like, don't.
I mean,
feel
there's
you need
so much available on Netflix.
Exactly.
There's so many other things available, movies, whatever else. I mean, if I have to
why
watch
waste
something.
Your time?
And just think of it as being rubbish to enjoy it. Don't know about that.
Yeah, you're struggling there.
We have one more. Let's take it back. 25-year anniversary of Titanic. Let's take a look back. If you haven't seen it. Like Leo's girlfriend.
Oi!
Are we taking a look at it?
We don't. You know, Leonardo DiCaprio's girlfriend is so young that she would have never even been alive when this was released.
Yeah,
let's just talk about that.
This is the 25th anniversary, and his girlfriend, Eden Peloni,
is 19.
She's 19 years old. He's 48.
Does it still hold up?
Oh God, of course it does. Yeah, of course it does. Come on, like, it's Titanic. It's a modern classic. Like, it's so good.
It's
and
so good.
This is all remastered, so it's like it's the best possible quality to see it in. You'll see it in 3D. It's 25th anniversary.
Is it back in cinemas?
It's back in cinemas, yeah, from Friday, yeah.
I went to see this in the cinema when I was only like 13, 14, yeah, whatever, and the old steamy scene with the parents, so that was an awkward one.
Oh, were you with the parents?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, no. In the car?
The hand up against the window.
I couldn't be...
Wow, and did you know what French ladies were back then? Did you?
But listen, great, like, it's a modern classic.
How many times did you go to see it in the cinema?
Only once, I think.
Oh, my God.
How many times
did
you go to see it in the cinema?
About 75 times.
Yeah,
Between that and Romeo and Juliet, I basically lived in the cinema when I was 13
years old.
Yeah,
I know, it's no Top Gun.
And it's nominated for Best Picture.
I know, it's definitely going to win.
They will never stop.
Give us a star.
5 out of 5. Come on, it's Titanic.
Yes. Would you
I think I'd go back and see it in the cinema.
You would, wouldn't you?
I'm going to go back, yeah.
I mean, look, I mean, like I say, this is, if you've never seen it in the cinema, this is the best time to do it because it's all remastered. It's exactly as it should have been. So, yeah.
Can I just say, a double feature, Titanic, yourself and Lucy, Titanic, then into Magic Mike. You're having a great weekend. It's all good.
We're both getting what we want to see there.
Both getting.
Hey, Brian Lloyd from Entertainment.ie. Thank you so much.
Thanks,
time
Brian.
For a short break. See you in a couple of minutes.
Oh, Lord, it's coming up to V-Day, so love is in the air, isn't it? And that means we've got to start dressing smart.
I never do anything for Valentine's, but I know so many of you do and want to get dressed up and go out on dates, and Mandy Maher is here to show us what to wear on our date night.
So we have to change that, folks, this weekend. We have to get out there and about and make the most of Valentine's.
His life is one continual day.
I know it is.
He's out every night of the week.
I don't think you should have a day to say I love you to your partner.
True, that is true. I do agree with you on that, but it is nice to celebrate the weekend that's in it, and it's obviously, you call it the love week, not just on one day.
And to be fair, if you're parents and it's hard to get out and you go, do you know what, we're going to have it this weekend. Fair play to you.
Yep. Yes.
Each their
absolutely.
Own. Yeah.
You do your thing.
So we're going to look at some looks. Our first look today, Michelle is on Michelle.
Yes, we have something kind of for everybody today because some people's form of dressing up is very different, and
absolutely.
This is why we're showing a different collections this morning. And I'm loving this particular dress. It's from Nell's Boutique, which is in Athlone. And again, like that for me, it's a type of dress that I think you probably could wear from day to night. So for somebody that maybe not into the too glam, a dress like this really, really works. It's a very simple dress. As you can see, there's not over fussing with it. It's a very, very small print flower on it. Lovely green. It has that elastic waist, which is also very forgiving, which is great. And a very not over low V neckline.
I know. And we're saying, go out on a date night. And people might think, posh restaurants, stuff like that. But for some people, it might be just going
Magic
for a little
Mike.
Drink.
Absolutely.
For a little drink or something like that. So this would be perfect.
It's absolutely
just
perfect.
The two is going out together somewhere.
It is, and it works really well. And as well as that, it's a great dress that you can wear more casually. Obviously, obviously today now we teamed up a little bit dressier with this beautiful little velvet bag. Isn't it fabulous?
Yeah.
This is from Lucena's shoe boutique, also based in Athlone, and it's the most incredible collection of shoes and bags. But that's what we did with this. We kept the bag a little bit dressier, if you could go more of a day bag if you wanted to.
And you're matching the shoes with it. Is that a velvet on the shoes?
It is a velvet shoe as well, and they're platforms. And get used to the platforms, ladies, because this is what you're going to be seeing, an absolutely massive amount. You're shaking your head.
I've got my pairs ready to go.
It's really all about the platform this season. Very on trend, but I'm loving this look. Really, really, as I said, it's something that's a little bit more pared back from being overdressed.
And you've some nice jewellery with it.
We did. We teamed it up then with the jewellery. The jewellery is also from Nell's boutique as well. Just simple drop earring, Alan, as you can see here. Picking up the little black, as you can see, pearl on that is picking up obviously with the bag and shoes, and the same on the chain as well, just a simple chain. Again, like that, I would say don't go OTT with the jewellery on this, because the dress does enough with the flower print.
Yeah.
You don't need to go over with the top.
Okay. And it's a mood lifter.
Yes,
gorgeous colour.
Yeah.
Lovely, Michelle.
Lovely.
Thank you so much for look one. We're going to move on.
Pat's here.
And Pat is here all the way from Cork this morning. Our gorgeous Pat is always rocking the looks.
Pat's been strolling around the place all morning, chatting to everybody.
She is. She's loving life this morning, and got Shane Byrne's photograph of the whole shebang.
Oh,
she's hilarious.
There you go, the mullet.
And she's telling me that she's working very hard, and I'm looking and thinking, where are you? I can't find you. But anyway, but I'm loving this look, and Pat always, forever, is ever so stylish, but I'm loving this orange print, leopard print dress. Again, like that, the print isn't over the top, but it's beautiful and very elegant.
Yeah, because I'm looking at that, I wouldn't have said that's a leopard print.
It is.
I know, but it's not as striking as some of the leopard print.
And it's beautiful, and I'm loving the orange. We all love a pop of colour, but again, like that, it's a dress that you can wear with the heels or easily wear with a pair of boots and pare it down for more of a day wear look.
Did you add the belt?
We added the belt to it as well.
It's the belt you have just under the bust.
Yeah, that's where we actually placed it this morning. But I'm again, like that, you could go with or without the belt. To me, I felt that the dress needed a belt to cinch in the waist better on it. That was my own feeling on it. We then teamed up then with this beautiful painting bag. It's a Lodi bag, a great label from Lucena's Shoe Boutique as well. And of course, then teaming the whole lot then with this gorgeous pair of slingback shoes.
Yeah, they're beautiful shoes as well.
Aren't they fabulous? And they have
nice
a fantastic collection of shoes as well. And it's
getting
a beautiful heel, if you can note the heel on those as well, very different. But are comfortable, which is also important. This thing of wearing heels and not being able to walk with them, I don't understand it. So
I know.
And the hoop earrings.
And then we just went with the little hoop earring. Then again, kept it quite simple. Didn't go over the top with the jewellery, but again, a beautiful hoop earring. You probably can't see at the back, but they actually have a
little pearl
clasp at the back. Just for something a little different.
What kind of pearl?
Why wouldn't the pearl be at the front?
Well, it's just the way
just
it
a
is.
Bit different.
That's fashion. Don't start confusing things here, for God's sake.
You've got to sell more of them. You've got one at the front, you can get one at the back.
Yeah, I know. Thanks, Merle.
Jamie, Pat, you look fantastic there. Thank you so much.
This is beautiful. This is all from Fusion Fashion Boutique in Mycullen in Galway. But we showed this a little bit earlier, but for me, it's a real Parisian style dress. It's fabulous. Again, obviously a little bit more dressier this time around. Have that big button detail there. Now, if you wanted to be very adventurous, what you could do is replace the buttons and utilise the outfit big time if you wanted to rechange it.
Yeah.
But I love the muted colour because we're keeping with the tones, obviously.
Just in this colour?
It is just in this colour. It is 3/4 inch, so it is a little bit shorter. But again, like that,
it's very stylish, isn't it?
It's so elegant.
Yeah, it's so elegant.
Kira, you look unreal.
Kira always rocks it, for sure. And then we teamed up then with this beautiful bag. Again, like that, if you notice, we did keep the colours quite similar. We didn't go mad with the colours with this dress. We kept them quite muted. And a beautiful gold bag with a chain, of course. And then we teamed it up then with these great knot style shoes.
Yeah. Glitz in the shoes.
Isn't it gorgeous? These also come in pink and black as well, the shoes do. But again, like that, we kept it very muted, the full look, but it works and it's classic and it's chic. And that's one tip I would give anyone when they're picking their wardrobe. Sit back and think what accessories you're going to put with it, because accessories can actually make or break.
Because you've just done a drop earring.
You can see the pearl in this one.
Thanks, Alan. God almighty. You're tough work this morning on me. But anyway, I'm loving these. And again, I'm a big fan of pearls. And pearls this time of year, always very stylish.
With the classic red lip on Kira there.
Kira, your hair is fab as well.
Isn't she the edgiest ever?
Yeah. I think it's one of my favourite looks that we've had come out here. That is absolutely gorgeous.
Yeah, Maren will be running around to buy that now.
I know she will.
That's really fantastic. I love that. Now, Michelle is back.
So Michelle is back. And Michelle, we're staying with Fusion Fashion in my colour. And Michelle is rocking it all up this morning. So as I said to you, the four looks are very different this morning.
Fair play.
But I'm loving the rock chick look going on here. And I'm massive fan, and anyone that knows me personally knows what I'm like for biker style and jackets. Love it.
Yeah.
You can never go wrong. It's like a wardrobe staple. It's like the blazers. These biker jackets, you'll have them forever. They never go out of date, basically.
It's the one for life.
Exactly. Yeah. And it is real leather. I do want to note that. It is actually a real leather jacket as well.
Okay, so going underneath this sort of geometric print, very cool.
It is. It's the monochrome mini dress. And again, like that, it's not too short. It's above the knee, but it's showing a little bit of leg and not too much, because some people are quite conscious of wearing something a bit shorter. But again, like that, it's rocking up the full look. It has a beautiful sleeve detail, as you can see here as well.
Gorgeous.
It has the belt. The belt is matching it, obviously. Again, like that, if you wanted to play around with that, you could easily add something different.
Do anything else you want there. You're going with a classic bag.
Went with a classic quilted chain bag then to pick it all up. Which works quite well. It's your bag like that, you'll never go out of fashion either. You'll always have it.
No.
And then teams up then with these great shoes. Again, like that, shoes coming in orange and in pink.
Turn to the side there just to show that.
Yeah, they've got a gorgeous little heel as well.
Yeah.
With the knot detail there.
And the knot detail on the side as well.
I like those.
Yeah, they're loaded. Great label. Really fantastic for
sure. Beautiful.
Earrings.
And then we went with the earrings to complement the full look then with this black and white drop earring, and that's the full look.
I think you get loads of wear out of that look now.
Isn't it gorgeous?
Yeah.
And again, like that, you can wear a pair of little biker boots with that dress as well. So there's lots you could do with to bring it more down if you wanted to dress it up in the evening with the heels.
You're as good as gold. Mandy Maher, thank you so much.
And happy Valentine's Day.
Happy Valentine's Day. And she came to my rescue with a steamer this morning for my coach, so thank you for that,
no problem.
Okay, coming up next, we're talking about female solo travelling. We'll see you in a few minutes. Thanks for staying with us. Now, are you considering jetting off on a solo trip?
Journalist Claire Scott is with us to share some tips and tricks. Claire, thank you so much for joining us. You headed off for 8.5 months by yourself,
yes,
which a lot of people would be intimidated by, because the world is a big place. You never know what's going to happen. So what did you think? Was it a good experience?
It was incredible. And I think it's one of those things that if you have it in you, you think you might want to do it, I think try and make plans now to get yourself out to do it, because you just feel so independent, you feel so liberated. Everyone that I've met along the way who's doing this or has done this feels the exact same way. Mm. It's just something that if you want to travel, you want to see the world, doing it by yourself is something you should try at least once in your life.
I think people might be watching in this morning and they think, oh, that's all great for a young person, but if you're slightly older, it's probably more intimidating, is it?
I'm sure it is, but I think post-pandemic, people are really just thinking, look, life is short. This is somewhere I want to go. No one wants to come with me. I have the money now. I'm a bit older. I'm going to do it. Intrepid actually are seeing a huge rise in older women, not necessarily single, but older women just saying, I'm going to go.
Yeah.
I'm
jetting off. Surely Valentining. They're like,
yeah, they literally are. Yeah, they're just jetting off, which is incredible.
It's just so fantastic. But I suppose an awful lot of the issues, I know for men and women, but sometimes women would be worried about solo traveling by themselves because of safety issues. And any true crime podcast, you're hearing nightmares about solo travelers for couples as well. Like, it's,
of course,
there's bad things. So what are tips for that? And are there things that you have to be aware of?
I think so. And I think it obviously is for women in particular. It's a bigger issue. I mean, you're more likely something's going to go wrong if you're a woman. Unfortunately, that's just the way the world is. But you can prepare yourself. I think the biggest thing is just planning. If I was, landing in a completely new country, I don't know anything, I'll make sure I have data on my phone. So there's a great app called Aralo. And basically, you can just buy data and download it onto your phone. So it's an eSIM. And you immediately activate it the minute you land. So say you're landing in Mexico, or you're landing in Colombia, wherever you are, you immediately have data on your phone.
That's great.
And I always make sure, can I use Uber here? Can I use Grab? So actually you can use Uber anywhere in South America, Central America, and it's really safe because they track as you're moving.
They track the driver,
So now that's not to say the taxis can be very safe too, but it's just for your own security. Yeah. You know you're being tracked. You know exactly where you're going to go. And also another tip is to get in touch with your hostel or your hotel the minute you land and look, tell them, look, I'm on my way. I'll see you in a few minutes, or I'll see you in half an hour.
And so then if you don't arrive or if you're hours late, they know that something has happened.
Yeah,
I mean, for people for people looking in this morning and they're going, OK, I want to try something. Mm. Did you... You went for 8 months.
I did.
It was a long stint.
A big stint.
Did you know exactly a rough guide of where you were going to go, or did you plan it bit by bit?
I did. I had a rough idea of what I was going to do, and I broke it up with trips, kind of group... trips as well. So travelling with G Adventures is fantastic. So basically you're still going solo, but you're getting to go
with a group. With a group. Yeah.
Yeah. So they launched their Romy's trips, which is for 18 to 35 year olds. Basically you just rock up and you're in a group of maybe, you know, 15 to 20 people from all over the world, and you're all jetting off across this.
That's
you know,
great.
It's
That's
a great idea.
It's incredible. Yeah, it's great. So your itinerary is sorted, and you have...
Oh, see, I'd like that.
Yeah, you have. And so especially for places like Bolivia and Peru, where it's kind of complicated to navigate these countries by yourself, getting buses and things, and especially if you don't have the language, you have a group leader or a CEO, chief experience officer is what they call them for G Adventures. And they will, they know the language, they know the route, they know everything, you know, like the back of their hand. So that takes the stress out of it for you. So I treated myself with those as well.
That's
they were
amazing.
Great.
Treated, is it just a little bit more expensive or a lot more expensive?
Only particularly for those trips, Romy's trips, because you're doing the hostels. So they're actually much cheaper than a lot of the other kind of group travel options on the market at the minute.
Okay. So for you, if someone is out there, and they're kind of thinking, OK, there's one place I want to go and I can't get anyone to go with me.
Yeah.
It's obviously been a very positive experience. Mm. Where in the 8.5 months, because you went everywhere, I don't think it was Australia, but you went like almost everywhere else.
Yeah.
What was the one that you were like, this is amazing?
Oh, I think Peru, and then I also got to go to Ecuador, and I was in Ecuador for a very long time. I paid guts of like 3 weeks, up to a month, and that's quite underrated, but it was fantastic as well. Headed out to the Galapagos.
Oh, Galapagos Islands.
Yeah, I got to go snorkeling with penguins while they were hunting for fish, and there was just so many things on that I didn't realise I needed on a bucket list that were ticked off anyway, type of thing.
Yeah.
So it was just surreal. And Peru, just the hiking, the mountains, just the landscape there is just out of this world. You won't see it anywhere else. It's just beautiful.
And
I highly recommend it.
I'm sure there's people looking in this morning and they're going, God, 8.5 months. First of all, how did you get the time off?
I
and then
know.
Were family and parents not worried about you going, you're going away for 8 months, what are you doing?
Yeah. All of that. Yeah, my editor was fantastic. He was great. He said, look, you know, you were covering the pandemic for 2 years, so we'll give you the time off. So I was delighted and very kind of him. And family were very worried, of course, but I was just like, look, guys, it'll be all right. Now, I didn't know it was going to be all right, but I told them it was going to be all right.
And it was fine. For you, it was a positive
It was what I wanted to take myself out of my comfort zone. I wanted to do something different. I did it, and it's worth it.
Claire Scott, it's been a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you so much.
The data on the phone, that's very, very, very
really handy.
Very handy. I've always wanted to go to Vietnam and Carl won't come with me. Will I go on my own?
Do it.
Yeah,
stay in the hostels.
No, I won't stay.
He will stay. He will no more stay in
Tell
a
me
hostel.
Tell me, have you stayed in a hostel?
I have, yeah. Lots of times.
Yeah. You're the only person I've ever met that
it.
Has never stayed
I went
in a hostel.
I've traveled on my own a couple of times. Great.
Did you?
Yeah, yeah. Very good. South America, Mexico, and
maybe
Thailand,
I'll go to Vietnam on my own then.
Mexico.
Sure he will.
Anyway.
That is all we've got time for. Coming up on Friday's Ireland AM, get ready for some serious 90s nostalgia. Rhino from the Gladiators is going to be on the show.
Comedian Eric Lawler will be chatting about how he performed stand-up with the biggest kidney stone known to man. What?
And we're going to bring you up to date on the latest from the Love Island villa. Amazing. Don't you just love Ireland, eh? Elaine, Martin and Kathy will be back from 7.
Tune in just for the kidney stone.
We'll get Jet for you on Monday.
Oh,
how about that? Jet from the Gladiators.
I would love.
See you. Bye-bye.
Jet.